call. You know, no one should pressurize you into having to buy the Galliano jacket or the Galliano skirt, you know, the whole lot. You can mix it.
The transparent tops. Everybody's saying as we move into the 90s, everybody's going to get a bit more sort of thoughtful and conservative. And those, like, left nothing to modesty. Can you see women wearing those in the 90s?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
And how? I mean, going out to dinner with those transparent tops on?
Yeah, why not? If you feel good in it. The girls certainly look beautiful in it. It's more to do with personality dress than the 90s. You know, that's what it's about.
Yeah.
It's putting on your favourite pieces, whether it's a sequin vest with torn denims, whatever, you know, that's green.
The King's Road, there's been lots of discussion as to whether or not this venue should have been separated from Olympia. I know you and Jasper have been two of the prime motivators in moving it here. Think the move was worth it?
Definitely, most definitely, yeah.
What was it you were looking for in coming here?
Well, I just wanted London to move into the 20th century, you know. The facilities we had before were just diabolical.
The whole situation is so difficult because we actually wanted there to be a fashion week and the designers did not want to be in the tent at Olympia. So we decided we had to come to the Duke of York's barracks and try and make everything as easy as we possibly could. Having said that, Milan moves around all the time too, and so does Paris. So we're not the only country that you have to sort of speed from one place to the other.
But the facilities in Chelsea are not obviously on a par with, for example, Milan.
No, they're not, absolutely not. But then we don't have the kind of money that Milan has in which we can pour into the industry and have wonderful loos, for instance, which we don't have here.
In general, it works, but there are problems. For example, I've just stepped off a coach which made a fruitless journey from the Pam Hogg show to Anthony Price, miles away in SW9, only to find that Anthony Price's show had finished because it actually started on time. So we had to turn around and come back and just hope that we didn't miss Vivienne Westwood.
It seems to be a new trend in all the fashion capitals to fragment, to show all around town. It's very hard work for us, you know, hard work for everybody, and I'd much rather see British fashion brought under one roof, one venue again.
So you think it's a mistake the designers coming down here to Chelsea and then leaving the exhibition at Olympia?
I long to be in Chelsea. Now I'm away, I long to be able to look around, walk down the King's Road, but there's no time. There's been no time between shows to see Olympia, which has looked terrific. I want to be able to see as much as possible, not spend my time sitting in a taxi cab.
Now, the reason the designers gave for coming here was that the facilities were going to be better. Have you found them as a journalist much more improved?
The long runway here is good for seeing clothes, but of course not all the designers can fill it. As far as telephones and things like that go, the facilities aren't better here. I think this is a bit of designers being prima donnas. I don't blame them for that, but I would like to think that the British Fashion Council can really call the tune in future.
Now, you decided not to show a collection this time. Why was that?
I felt it was really rude to people to invite them to this country and have them trail all over London for two big venues. Why not one venue? We need one venue like this tent with two other tents attached to it, which we used to have, and we need sponsorship. It needs to be glamorous and wonderful. And then the trade show is something separate at Olympia.
So you really feel that Olympia should do what it's doing over there and that there should actually be much better facilities here in King's Road?
I do, and I know we can get the money for it, and I know we must just organise ourselves so that we are having glamour and theatre in one place and trade in another.
But I know you've always been very vocal about your attitudes about British fashion. Do you not cut off your nose to spite your face saying, right, I'm not going to show?
Oh, no. You can dip a season for reasons of ill manners or whatever. No, you're always there if you're good.
I think we've done as well as we can at the moment. But if you think that about, I saw 3 months ago, there wasn't going to be a British Fashion Week, and now we've actually got one, I think that's the way we should be thinking rather than worrying about, you know... I mean, actually, we should be worrying about what's happening next time, I guess.
No matter what I do. But while the controversy was discussed much by everyone who'd come to see the shows went on.
Alistair Blair back with a bang, a designer who really does understand what an international collection of clothes should be about. His Trompe l'Oeil St. Trinian's Girls with sequin ties was the kind of spoof that his old boss Karl Lagerfeld pops in from time to time. Rounded off with black and white flowers and stripes. It seems that all the designers bought op art books to take on holiday this summer.
In terms of our recognition as Britain on the international scene, you're competing against guys like Armani and Versace and Lagerfeld to get that international buyer. How difficult is that for you?
It's difficult, I think, because I'm based in London, and I mean, unfortunately, a lot of those buyers still don't come to London. It's just something they miss. London is still the poor cousin of the fashion world, and it's going to be for quite a while, I think, and that's the problem we're all dealing with. I'm selling now in Paris this week, in actual fact, and hopefully I'll, you know, generate more business there.
Now, why are we still the poor relations?
I think it's guilt by association, in actual fact. I think we've had such a bad reputation now for so many years, and in the last four or five, at least, as far as I can remember, I think it's been well organised, some of it. It's been pretty well put together. It's been wearable, commercial clothes that the British designers are turning out. But people, when you still say, I still have the same problem when I say I'm based in London, you see their faces drop because they don't come, or they, you know, they think everything's held together with scotch tape and spit. And it's not, you just get over that hurdle now. It's a mental thing now I think we've got to overcome.
Red or Dead have been in business since 1982, and for the last 2.5 years, John McKittrick has been quietly designing clothes to be stocked in the 7 Red or Dead outlets. Now, he and owner Wayne Hemingway have decided the time is right for a catwalk show. It's called Space Baby, and the fashion world waits with bated breath.
What do you think the catwalk show is going to provide for you?
Well, a catwalk show is, number one, expensive. So we've tried to cut a few corners by offering models a bit, getting them at a cheaper price and doing a lot more work ourselves in-house. What it should provide is increased press exposure, which leads to increased sales, hopefully.
What does the bank manager think when you actually go around to him to sort of give your projections for the future and you sort of like tell him this is the theory behind it?
We don't. Red or Dead's one of the few companies that's totally self-funding. We've never had a bank overdraft, never had a loan. We've just grown. As we've got some money, we've expanded. So we're not beholden to any banks.
What's the theme behind Red or Dead for Spring 90?
It's called the Space Baby Collection. It's the theme is don't worry about the future, in safe hands, and it's a light-hearted look at all the environmental issues that are about now, and a light-hearted look on futuristic clothes.
Now, who wears the stuff? Who is it that you're aiming for?
People who just want to be different, I suppose, and who don't want to spend a fortune on being different, or things aren't too expensive. Japan's our biggest market, apart from the UK. One reason is that they love dressing up, and they've got a high disposable income, and they spend a fortune on clothes. Plus, the kids try and outdo each other, and Red or Dead clothes are the perfect clothes to make a statement in. At the moment, we've been trying to think of the daftest thing we can, and then going away and making those daft ideas commercial and wearable.
Like a lot of other fashion reporters this week, I spent more than my fair share of time in taxis, going from one venue to another. But one journey that was particularly rewarding was one I made south of the river to Brixton to see Anthony Price's collection. Sexy and still sexier dressing is something, of course, Anthony Price has made almost all his own. His energetic show pulled in, as always, those who were into the business of glamour in a mega way. Lace and rope, fringe and bustier, cloth to see through, and fabric to be wrapped tight in, all came through as confidently as you would expect from someone who spent 25 years learning his particular business. After 25 years, don't you feel slightly
jaded?
I was going to say that, but slightly jaded.
Well, it's a funny old business. It's something you, I can do lots of other things, like putting up the lights and building the catwalk. I love doing that more than anything, and I'm never allowed to do that. I was there this morning putting up all the lights, and they all think I'm a lighting technician, but I love that, the technical side of it.
I don't believe that totally.
It's true, and my dresses are very technical anyway. They're incredibly difficult to put together, and they're sort of architecture, and they're not easy to make, but I can do it, and there's a few of us who can do it. But I don't really do casual little numbers. I mean, basically England is about selling evening wear, really, because the money that you can ask for a garment after 6 o'clock at night is considerably more than an incredibly labour-intensive suit. But it's the cost of making things here.
So who buys your clothes?
They sell all over the world, really. I mean, to rich, well-off women who want to look good. You know, not. I think they're women who are married to somebody with money and wish to stay married to him.
Victoria Lockwood's wedding dress for her marriage to Viscount Althorp last month gave a high-octane note to this, the first catwalk show from the designer of her dress, Thomas Starshevsky. Thomas's regular clients turned out to support him as he put on a tight little show whose accent was very firmly on dressing grown-ups. And no one enjoyed it more than the woman who gave Thomas his promising start in the couture business, his mum.
What did you think of it?
I think all dresses are very nice. There is not one which I wouldn't wish to show. Even a wedding dress which I made yesterday was all right.
You made yesterday, did you say?
I'm making samples.
Did you?
Yes.
So you've been...
More samples are made by me.
Why have you done all this?
Because he's my son. He didn't have money or... It's very difficult to start for young people.
Of course, the wedding of the Viscount Althorp.
Yes.
And his bride,
yes.
Was much publicised. Were you upset by the publicity that it got? There was a lot of nasty things said.
All of us were upset because it's the first time that we've dealt with the press, and we were warned on Friday that the press were out to kill. And so it doesn't matter what you do.
But in the end, has the dress and the publicity surrounded it helped you?
I don't know, because we have what the press don't write is actually all the stores that I've been selling to for the last 5 years.
And then tell us who.
People like Bergdorf's, Neiman Marcus, Saks, Harrods, Fortnum's, Lucy and Phillips. I mean, we sell to a lot of stores.
But how do you keep up the demand, for the demand? I mean, you must be with your mother and
well,
all
we
that.
We have our girls that work for us, and we have our workers. And
we have team working.
We have a team, a proper team. I mean, the wedding dress was a special in-house project. I mean, it's, you can say it's a labor of love.
And wedding dresses I am making.
It's sort of like she's in charge of wedding dresses.
Yes.
The shows this week have been remarkable for the number of top international models who stepped out onto the catwalk, including one American girl once known for her beautiful long hair, Linda Evangelista.
You're the woman who gave new meaning to hair, short hair. Well, it's obviously a question because you've graced the pages of Vogue magazine, Harper's in this country. Has it been a decision that you've regretted in any way whatsoever?
For about the first 2 weeks when everybody cancelled me. I mean, I got cancelled for fashion shows and... Nobody understood the haircut at first, but no, I haven't regretted it. I make much more money now.
That's great. So it's come full circle for you?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
When you first had it done, did you go and hide your head in your hands and say, I wish I had never had it done, even though I understand it?
I lost all my confidence when I cut it off. I had long hair for such a long time, and my whole career was up on the line there, but after about a month, I realized that it was going to work out.
It cut every 2 weeks, I hear. To keep
or
it in shape.
Every week, because it grows really fast over the ears. And a lot of hairdressers have thanked me because their salons are doing so much better now because the women have to keep coming in more often than when they had long hair and just came in for their 6 month trim.
Half of your personality must have gone though. You must feel it's gone with it not being there any longer.
I can't move like I used to.
Pam Hogg has shown for several seasons with Hyper Hyper, but this time breaks away to do her own thing on the catwalk. This is a particularly trying time for any first-timer, but Pam's creativity and sense of humour are bound to get her through. Black lycra bodysuits for women and see-through vests and patent shorts for men kicked off the show. It was very definitely a family affair. Friends lent their bodies on the catwalk and their organisational skills backstage. The black-themed, brightly coloured lycra bodywear caught the eye of everybody present, and flashes clicked furiously at these and the heavy velvet jackets with Elvis stand-up collars. Congratulations, Pam. May this be the first show of many.
Ghost wooed the foreign buyers yet again and goes from strength to strength. Overdyed crepes with cutwork and embroideries with even a hint of print. Antique colours that look like sun wash shutters from Barbados and Jamaica and highlighted with Rasta colours. The finale had to be the most overcrowded of the weekend, a blues party to celebrate the great collection.
The raison d'etre of Fashion Week is, of course, to sell clothes. And it's not the home market that's important that has the power. It's the overseas buyers and the international journalists that have the most influence, particularly the Americans.
I find the British designers very original, very creative, very imaginative, sometimes a little wild and far out, but they give impetus to the more conventional, more conservative designing of the Americans. And they cut new ground. I think they're marvelous. Unfortunately, they're not terribly disciplined and haven't really made the impact themselves. They influence others. If they were more disciplined and better financed, perhaps, they would have a greater impact on the world fashion scene in terms of making money for Great Britain.
I think the British have always been very influential as far as fashion. They suffer from a lack of ability to have the gigantic financing behind them to manufacture the way the Italians, French, and Americans do. So I think they have the problem of being small.
So as a big American player, do you take British fashion seriously, or is it the icing on the cake?
It's directional.
London represents something else in the world.
You've been coming here since the 60s, and you know what it was like here when we really used to sell bucket loads to America. Why aren't we able to do that these days?
Because fashion has changed, and I think Americans come here looking for that kind of throwaway fashion, quick, trendy thing. You had the punks, but that's the last major one that I remember. I think that's what people come from. They still remember the 60s, and they still come for the street scene, and not for international fashion.
Now, what have we got to do to get ourselves on that international map where it can mean real money to the designers?
God, if I knew that, I'd set up shop. I think it's clear that this is a less expensive market than Milan, let's say, where we've just come from. So we have to concentrate within that moderate, you have to concentrate within that moderate field and do clothes that are acceptable. But it's a tough thing, because if they're too weird, the acceptability is quite limited. And yet that is what people come to look for ideas. And that's why what happens to London design is people sort of pick up a piece of the idea, interpret it, and after a while you don't know whether it originated in Japan, in London, in Paris. It's been so worked over. I mean, I think everybody thinks of London as the hotbed of originality.
And is that going to be right for the 90s, do you think?
Sure, but they have to learn how to make the clothes better.
I think British fashion has certainly grown up over the last few seasons, and we're very pleased with the things that we're finding here. There's a refinement and a bit of elegance that's really nicer than what has been here before.
So what, Bloomingdale's no longer looking for wild, wacky London?
Oh, I don't think anyone's looking for wild and wacky, especially anymore. Our customer's growing up just as the designers are. And I think what we're finding here is London that's really moving into the next time period. The look of King's Road, that very wild, spiky kind of look, is not as popular as it was anywhere in the world. And so we're moving into the next decade.
Much is expected from Vivienne Westwood in her fifth collection of the series Britain Goes Pagan. She has repeatedly delivered the goods on the ideas front and still remains Britain's most innovative and eccentric designer.
You're fine, anytime. Got to tell this world that you're mine, 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 mine. I like to watch you when you're in the gym, just making sure that you don't get too thin. Come on, baby, drive me crazy. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Me like I love it. publisher.
So what were the clothes all about for this show?
Well, I wrote a blurb, which I can remember. I got it all in one paragraph. I don't know whether people will understand it, but it was the half-dressed city gent finds himself with Odysseus in an Arcadia of 18th century porcelain shepherdesses who frolic with the fauns and satyrs.
It's a fairly easy theme to follow. Tell me something about all of the arrangements for this week. You came over here to Chelsea. Do you think it's been a good move to come here?
I would have liked better facilities in terms of cups of tea for people, wine to drink when they got here, things like that. I do care about the people who come here. I would have liked them to have been treated a little bit more, you know, like it's such a beautiful green area with this tent. It's rather like a garden party. It would have been nice if they could have had tea and sandwiches and stuff when they got here.
What is it you like about what Vivian does?
Her flamboyancy. Everyone's so boring in the 80s. The 80s will be remembered as the era of spindly black Italian furniture and boring clothes.
And except Sarah it? Stockbridge, because you've never been boring in the 80s, have you?
Well, I was for a while, until Vivian got hold of me.
I mean, do you come here especially to be outrageous during Vivian's shows?
No, I'm not aware that I am outrageous.
Come on, you know it. I mean, those guys,
no,
they're all shouting your name.
Is the word.
Is that what you want to be?
Yeah, entertaining.
Yeah? I mean, do you enjoy that kind of minute on the catwalk when everybody's looking at you?
Oh, yeah, it's great. A catwalk is a brilliant thing to perform on as well, because it's like, oh, I don't know, it's better than a stage. I like it. Kiss me, baby. Ooh, feels good. Hold me, baby. Hold me, baby. Want you to love me like I love a should. You're fine. Anytime. Got to tell this world that you're mine, 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 mine. I like to watch you when you're in the gym. Just making sure that you don't get too thin. Come on, baby, drive me crazy. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. I just adore your sensational brain.
Well, after all the hysteria and hype of Fashion Week, this season will be remembered as the one in which one of our major design talents deserted the stage and defected to Paris. She's Catherine Hamnett, and she's so disenchanted with the way our designers are treated here that she's taken her show across the channel. Well, we'll be joining her there and finding out how other designers in the fashion capital of the world see 1990. Well, that's in a couple of weeks. But meanwhile, join us on Sunday tea time for our regular edition of The Clothes Show.